welcome to Dawai Kudroen, and I'm so Mugenla. For tonight, we have Mr. Kipchu Tshering, the Chief Executive Officer of Bhutan National Bank, as our guest here. Thank you very much for joining us. Sir, BNB has done good so far till 2012, if you go by the annual report of your bank. I believe it's not really doing, I mean, it has not been able to do well in 2013.
Sonam, it's true.
Yes.
That BNB has done exceptionally well
till 2012.
Since the beginning of the bank till
2013. Yes.
And 2013 has not been so much, but nevertheless, we are able to make a substantial profit.
Yes.
In terms of the profit, but the growth, as it was not so much as it was in 2011 and 12.
Nice.
In the 2011, we had 250 million. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that was 2010, it was 250 million.
Yes.
And 2011, it jumped to 500 million. And 2012, it jumped to 690 million.
Yes.
So there has been quantum jump in those years.
Yes.
But whereas in 2013, there has not been a jump.
No. Yes.
But there has been negative growth in profit.
Mm-hmm.
But that is due to the sluggish nature of the economy.
Oh, national economy.
Yes.
Yes. And I mean, considering the economic situation, it is likely that the banks, especially to talk on BNB, the growth rate of your bank, is it likely to remain the same, or will there be a possibility of improving situation?
It will definitely improve.
Yes.
But we are not expecting the kind of jumps what has been in the past.
Previous years.
The growth has been almost 100% growth.
Yes.
Most of the time.
Yes.
So that sort of thing may not be there, but we will definitely grow.
Mm-hmm.
In 2014, I would definitely expect to be much better than 2013.
Nice. So financial institutions play a very important role in the national economy. And the crisis we had, most people don't really use crisis, but it was a crisis, a rupee crisis. People say rupee shortage. And the bad economic shape that we have right now, people blame it partly to the financial institutions for lending money to only for the constructions and not really investing in agricultural sectors.
See, I think that is not at all a fair judgment.
Yes.
In my opinion, I think what the financial institutions have done so far has been an excellent progress,
mm-hmm.
both in the construction industry,
mm-hmm.
housing, mortgage loans,
yes.
and then also in the business loans.
Mm-hmm.
There has been a boom.
Yes.
Because of the previous government had spent a substantial amount in the farm roads, as a result of which a lot of contractors have got a job as a contractor.
Mm-hmm.
Then there was a requirement for import of a lot of machineries,
yes.
equipments,
yes.
and there was also a need for, as a result, the income of the people have jumped up.
Mm-hmm.
But there has been a problem in the export front.
Yes.
Because our export has not grown. And we are very much dependent on the imports, mm-hmm. rather than the exporting.
Exports.
So because of that, I think we face the rupee crunch.
Mm-hmm.
Agriculture sector is the main, I think, the livelihood of the rural economy. Has not really grown, and the policy, I think, it is not been on the commercial farming.
No,
but it was more towards the
subsistence
farming.
Mm-hmm.
So subsistence farming will not generate income for the rural farmers.
No, sir.
They will rather be living hand to mouth. So that sort of policy, I think it is not congenial for the economic growth of the country.
Yes. So if there are changes in that, and if people focus and emphasize on commercial farming, will the financial institutions in the country be able to give loans? And can we at least substitute imports?
Yes, definitely.
Yes.
We, all financial institutions, in fact, we have already expressed to the previous government that we are willing to finance the agriculture sector.
Nice.
But what we need to get is proper projects for the rural farming.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the way we should go about.
Nice.
Because what we are doing today is simply subsistence farming. And with the subsistence farming, I think there's not enough income for people.
Yes.
So the growth of the agriculture sector doesn't arise.
Considering the cultivatable land of the country, do you still feel as the head of the financial institutions, do you still feel the financial institutions country can make profit out of investing in the agriculture?
Well, I suppose that given the right choice of technology, right choice of guidance by the government and support from the government,
yes,
agriculture sector can boom.
Yes.
And particularly in the, I think we can also find out niche market.
Yes.
Even next door, India has a huge market for many of the crops which we can profitably produce in Bhutan and market it in India.
Mm-hmm.
But like, you know, even horticulture items, we can grow, you know, off season during the, what, when we produce our horticulture items in Bhutan, it is off season in India.
Yes.
So therefore there is definitely a market.
Yes.
So like mango,
mm-hmm,
could be profitably produced in southern and eastern Bhutan.
Yes.
In the warmer areas.
Mm-hmm.
So is pomegranate. We can easily grow in those warmer climates.
Nice.
So is, you know, the avocados. So is so many other fruits which can, you know, produce in Bhutan.
Nice.
And export it in the Indian market.
Mm-hmm.
There is enough market. And today, if you see ourselves, even in our own vegetable market here, we are producing those items which could be profitably produced in Bhutan. We are still importing it.
Nice, nice.
So therefore, I think we need to make it everything most commercialize the farms.
Nice, nice.
So,
for
yes.
For instance, tomorrow I come up with a fantastic project proposal, maybe to do a business on fishery, and your bank thinks it's a fantastic proposal. Would you be able to finance me directly, or would you like to have government in between?
See, we cannot give you direct loan.
Yes.
Until we are sure that there is a support system.
Yes.
So if it's in the fishery, you are a fishery farmer, but the fingerlings has to be supported by the government.
Yes.
The fishery water, main source of fishery, is the consistent flow of water.
Mm-hmm.
So that there is plenty of water source in Bhutan.
Yes.
So the government has to provide you a land where there is water.
Yes.
And then you can profitably grow that and provide you the backup technology.
Yes. Yes.
Which means the financial institutions, in terms of giving loans, we are there to provide.
Mm-hmm.
And we are willing to take a certain amount of risk.
Yes.
The financial institutions will take certain amount of risk in financing the agriculture.
Yes.
And that's the only way forward. Otherwise, our agriculture will be far behind and we will not be able to compete with the rest of the world.
Yes. So do you sometimes feel, considering the current situation of the country, do you sometimes feel that the financial institutions should also have thought about investing in agricultural sectors, perhaps educate government, perhaps educate the regulating authorities, and then also to invest in agriculture sector?
See, we are not here to give the education to the government.
Yes.
It is they who have to educate us. It is they have to educate the farmers.
Yes.
And it is the farmers, they have to approach the government.
Yes.
And basically, I think our farmers are, you know, not very literate.
Yes.
And they are not very, you know, entrepreneurial.
Yes.
So that's why there is no ideas. But there are wealth of ideas when people go abroad and see what is being done abroad. Say, like today, we can even, you know, with the grapes, you can produce grapes for table purposes. You can produce grapes for wine. And we have climate situations which is...
favorable.
You know, from a very warm to a very cold climate.
Yes, yes.
And therefore, there's no question that we cannot produce grapes in Bhutan.
Oh, nice.
There's no question that we cannot produce mango in Bhutan.
Nice.
There's no question that we cannot produce avocado in Bhutan.
Nice.
We have favorable climate conditions.
Nice.
Similarly, there are so many, you know, health food items which could be exported and we can sell, you
nice.
Know, the ideas to the next door. India is the big market.
Nice. Some people feel that it's not really a good decision for Bhutan to invest so much in the hydropower as we are doing currently. What do you feel on that? How do you view on this?
See, today Bhutan is in the hydropower. We are not contributing our own resources. Our only contribution is the
natural
land and the water.
Yes.
And maybe you know, some employment.
Nice.
But other than that, the resource, the money comes from India.
Mm-hmm.
The actual technology and know-how comes from India only.
Mm-hmm.
And they come with the money. And they come to Bhutan because they think that Bhutan has the best potential to produce hydropower.
Nice.
And because Bhutan is much more stable than India or even Bangladesh or neighboring countries. So, as a result, we can cheaply produce than the India themselves.
Yes.
And I think it is advantageous for both the country.
Yes.
And Bhutan, I think luckily it is hydropower which is sustaining the economy right now.
Yes.
Although it is the revenue so far we have generated is about 10 billion or something.
Mm-hmm.
But that amount itself is, without
huge.
Minus that, you can see what would have been the situation of Bhutan.
Yes.
We would not be what we are today.
But aren't we putting all eggs in one basket?
So as I said, we are not putting our own money.
Oh.
So money is coming from India and yes. India is putting their own money.
Yes.
And India is, there's a buyback guarantee.
Yes.
So as long as this is there, I think it is not a problem for us. But we always have to look for other alternatives.
Yes, diversify the...
We have to diversify into... Bhutan is a small population, with small country, small population.
Yes.
And we cannot, you know, we are not gifted with the, like, Switzerland.
Yes.
Where people have ideas of producing, you know, world famous watches. They become the most popular, you know, the small country like Switzerland also can produce the world's most requirement of the watches.
Yes.
So Bhutan also probably can do something, but we are not gifted in terms of the human resource. We are not gifted in terms of the finances.
Mm-hmm.
And we are not gifted in terms of our literacy rate.
Mm-hmm.
So far.
Yes.
But agriculture, I think we don't need to have all those.
Yes.
Probably someday we might come up with a product in the agriculture sector which can be sold anywhere in the world.
Yes.
And Bhutan could be a very famous country which produces something.
Yes.
Like Brazil is producing coffee. Vietnam is producing coffee. So probably we may be able to come up with a product which can be sold in the international market, and Bhutan can become famous with that.
Nice, nice. Just like the incident we had with the poultry and egg.
Yes.
Nice. It was purely from buffer's restriction that I think it was accident.
It's a demand. Everything is comes by the demand, because when there's no supply, the supply is restricted at the source, and there's a demand. People, it's by through sheer you know, the demand that has the buffer's stopping of the import of poultry items. People needed poultry items, so it has. Therefore, there was demand. So once the demand is there, I think we produce it. It was profitable to produce poultry, you know, items.
Nice.
So as a result, poultry, I think somehow it has come up in the market.
Nice.
So similarly, fishery. We can produce rainbow trout here. We can produce brown trout. We can produce even grass carps in the warmer areas. And even probably salmon also,
nice.
Freshwater salmon.
Nice, nice.
So these are, could be, if you have the know-how and technology, which I think the government has to come up.
Nice. So you and I comfortably talk about substituting food items, substituting meat items. But especially when you talk about substituting meat items, sometimes not necessarily from people who know, but from somewhere it comes, you know, in the form of religion, Buddhism, saying to slaughter animal, it's sinful, and they don't really, I mean, they condemn slaughtering. But the fact of the matter is they eat meat. And sometimes it has been stumbling block to growing economy also. How do you view that?
Yes, there is a certain element of the society shunning the, if you are in a butchered, or if you are producing something to kill,
yes,
or even to sell meat, even if you are a hotelier also, people don't really, many people don't really like it.
Yes.
But I think given the fact that there is a demand for all those, and given the fact that I think unemployment is growing, and there are a lot of people who are without jobs,
mm-hmm,
and there should be people, you know, not everybody wants to be butchered.
Yes.
Not everybody wants to grow to kill.
Yeah.
I mean, farm to kill. But there are, everybody wants to eat.
Yes.
We are importing everything
from elsewhere.
From elsewhere.
Yes.
And we are eating it.
Mm.
But why not? We grow ourselves. We farm ourselves and produce ourselves, and we can eat ourselves or even export it.
Yes.
So that way, I think our economy will at least sustain for self-sustenance,
yes,
at least that we will not be dependent on the elsewhere.
Yes.
And our scarce resources of rupee, which is being going for import of even piggery.
Yes.
You know, the meat and beef and all those items probably will be about 3 billion.
Yes.
But we cannot, we have to, I think, the oil and items which we don't produce at all, we have to be dependent.
Yes, yes. So let me pull you back to banking again, sir. You say the financial institutions would be comfortable to give out loans if you are doing commercial farmings. What about entrepreneurship, sir? What about who wants to run small-scale farmings, but commercial in nature?
Same thing.
Yes.
We have been giving the entrepreneurial loans and for the last even 20 years.
Yes.
And this has not been taken off because the mortality rate in those are very high.
Yes.
As much as 70-80%.
Yes.
On those small loans.
Yes.
We have been giving, you know, small entrepreneurial and artisan loans.
Yes.
But those are not really been taken off because of, one is that the entrepreneur development program is given only for 1 month.
Yes. Yes.
And 1 month you come up with a project report and we finance those projects.
Is it risk for you?
Yes, nice. But nevertheless, we are committed to do this.
Oh, nice.
So we are partly financing those, even though the mortality rate, the loss is as much as 70%, 75%.
Nice, nice. So, in Bhutan, again, I mean, you have faced low depositors in your bank with your banks, and in 2012, I believe it was. I mean, you suffered a negative growth of about 1.67 in deposits, and I believe it has gone down again in 2013. Don't you think it's because of low interest rate on deposits and high interest rate on lendings, like the loans?
The commercials does not permit us to offer extensively high
interest
rate on the deposits.
Nice.
Because we can marginally increase by 1 or 2%.
Nice.
And that means if we have to maintain our present profitability, then we have to increase the lending rate.
Nice.
But increasing the lending rate is not congenial for the growth of the economy as such, because many of the projects which could be made viable becomes unviable because of the high rate of interest.
Nice.
So is the any kind of business which is could be, they will not be making so much profit.
Nice.
So in the end, it all depends on the inflation.
Nice.
The inflation in India and Bhutan, because Bhutan's inflation is directly injected from India.
Nice.
The inflation rate is at least 7 to 8%.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are offering 7-8%, which is, if somebody is depositing with us at 7 and 8%, and then we are offering 7 and 8% rate of interest, within 5 years he is back to square one.
Oh, nice.
It is doesn't really thing, but it has to be, the lending has to be actually should be something above the inflationary rate.
Oh, nice.
Then it is makes sense for somebody to deposit with the financial institutions.
Oh, nice.
But today, because of the economic circumstances as such, we cannot charge a very high rate of interest.
Mm. Nice.
In some countries, the lending rate goes as much as 20-30%.
Oh, nice.
Where there is a lot of inflation. But in Bhutan, I think we have more of a controlled rate of interest.
Nice.
And we are very comparable to Indian lending rate.
Nice.
Deposit rate, we are slightly lower than the Indian, because they have, by sheer volume,
nice,
they can offer, and they have a higher rate of interest.
Nice.
And they have more products to be sold in the market.
Nice.
You know.
Sir, finally, sir, if the financial institutions are given a choice, I mean, whether to invest on the construction sectors or to invest in agriculture sectors, which would you prefer?
See, we have to do both.
Yes.
But at the same time, I think we have to take a certain element of risk in lending to the agriculture sector.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Agriculture sector, I think, is not a risk-free.
Yes.
It's always with the risk. But we can take certain amount of risk on a portfolio of, BNB's portfolio of the loans is almost 18.5 billion.
Mm.
And on 18.5 billion, if we lend, another $500 million to agriculture sector, not everything in agriculture, what we are lending into agriculture, is going to be bad.
Yes.
So maybe 40-50% may be bad, but if we should be in a position to take that that much of risk, and I think financial institutions are willing to take risk as long as the projects are viable.
Yes. So super final comment, sir. You consider your customers, your clients as, a very important part of your business. But why do you reflect their names, those who default on national television?
See,
are you trying to name and shame them?
This is not what we want to.
Yes.
But mainly because we are doing this, only people who we are not able to trace those people.
Oh, yes.
They have taken loans. And mostly they are from the government employee loan side, or even somebody who's owning a vehicle loan or something.
Yes.
Where they can disappear with the vehicle.
Oh, yes.
And government employee loan, once they're out of the service, they are not paying the loan, and then they just disappear somewhere.
Oh.
And we are not able to trace them.
But does it work to trace them out?
So, in a way, yes. So some people come forward and say, okay, I'm here, and
Nice.
But without informing that sort of thing, when we ask the police also finding it difficult to find.
Yes.
So there's no solution other than to announce in the media. So that's the only way we could
trace them out.
And it also, of course, it puts them into little shame.
Well, thank you very much for your time with us.
Thank you.
That was Mr. Kipchu Tshering, the chief executive officer of BNB. Thank you for watching the show.